So I'm going to present four papers that have been presented in the ESHRE last July regarding the topic of fertility preservation. So these are the four papers. The first one was a paper by Liebenthron from Germany, and he described how the regarded orthotopic ovarian tissue transplantation, and they presented how the transplantation of ovarian tissue in the peritoneum, the transplantation in more experienced transplanting center, and the overnight transportation of ovarian tissue does not impair the clinical results, but it improves the clinical results, and we will see it later on. The second paper by Bildik from Turkey is a very interesting paper, and it regards the molecular evidence against the preventive action of GnRH analogs co-treatment to the chemotherapy-induced damage in human ovary and granulosa cells. The third paper is by Simon from France, and he tried to find the threshold of AMH and of anthrofolical count under which it is not worth it to do in vitro maturation followed by oocyte followed by oocyte vitrification. And the fourth and the last one by Duros from France, he compared the FORT, and we will see what FORT is, follicular output rate. He compared the FORT after controlled ovarian hyperstimulation in cancer patients compared to not cancer patients, to fertility patients. And he found that there's absolutely no difference in the FORT in this group, in these two groups of patients. So we move to the first paper, orthotopic ovarian tissue transplantation results in relation to experience of the transplanting center, overnight tissue transportation, and transplantation into the peritoneum, the 3 points assessed by this paper. So let's see the background. The background is that cryopreservation of ovarian tissue prior to cytotoxic therapies and retransplantation is becoming increasingly common. So this sentence merits a very quick discussion. Increasingly common, yes, it's true, but how common? The only fertility preservation method that is not considered experimental by the ISRM and by the ESHRE is the vitrification of oocytes or embryos. And ovarian tissue transplantation and in vitro maturation of oocytes are considered experimental. Moreover, and we will see also the data that presented by Liebenthron. Moreover, the first report of baby born after ovarian transplantation by Donnet was back 1988. And sorry, 1998, and it's more than 15 years they have been born maybe 30, 35 babies all over the world. The use of centralized tissue banks and specialized transplantation centers may help to optimize these procedures. Ovarian tissue should be transplanted orthotopically, but may be transplanted elsewhere, for instance, in the peritoneum. So the aim of this study was to determine whether overnight transportation of ovarian tissue before cryopreservation and the degree of experience of transplantation center affects transplantation success and determine the success rates of transplantation into the pelvic peritoneum. So 94 transplantation performed in the network FertiProtect. I went to the internet and I looked at what is FertiProtect. FertiProtect is a network of fertility centers that are maybe 95 in Germany, 6 in Switzerland, and about 10 in Austria. So more than 100 centers that joined this network from 2007-2015. 94 transplantation in 8 years in more than 100 centers. Of course, you may say that not all centers do harvesting of ovarian tissue and transplantation, but this network is made by more than 100 centers. Of these 94 transplantations, 55 were excluded from the study from different reasons, and 39 transplantations were included in the study, made by 8 centers in 8 years. So this means that 5 each center made a mean of 5 transplantations in 8 years. The success rate was defined as tissue activity after 1 year. And you know that one of the most important aspects of ovarian tissue transplantation is that you have in about 60% of the transplantation, you have the restorage of the ovarian endocrine system. And but so far, the longest ovarian endocrine situation has been lasted 4 years. So success rate was defined as tissue activity after 1 year and number of pregnancies and delivered. Experienced centers have been considered those centers that have been performed more or equal than 3 transplantations. So the first thing is that 64 of all rare transplantation remained active for at least 1 year. And this is something important also from a psychological viewpoint from these women. The mean age was 30, and remember the mean age of these patients. And the pregnancy rate was 28%, 11 out of 39. And the deliveries was 23%. So now imagine that you have a woman of 30, and in a woman of 30, at least you can retrieve a mean on 15 oocyte, and at least you can vitrify 12, 15 mature oocyte. And we have published 3 years ago the cutoff level that statistically discriminate the chance of obtaining a pregnancy with vitrified oocyte. And in women, and the age is 38, and the number of oocyte is 8. So if you have a 15 oocyte retrieved in a woman of 30, the chance of having a pregnancy is more, cumulatively, is more than 50%, a pregnancy, a delivery. Remember, reflect on this. So the second issue that they wanted to demonstrate is that overnight transportation of tissue at 4 degrees centigrade prior to cryopreservation had a positive impact on the clinical outcome or a negative impact on the clinical outcome. Of course, and this is quite reasonable, the most experienced centers have to perform the retransplantation, the cryostorage and the retransplantation of tissue. But the other 90 centers that harvest the ovarian tissue have to transport this tissue to the most experienced centers. And this, of course, it takes some time. You have to keep the ovarian tissue at 4 degrees centigrade. And the question is this, with this approach, gives an impaired clinical outcome or not? And apparently the results is not, because the numbers are quite small, but with retransplantation overnight, with overnight transportation, you have apparently better results. But better results because they are retransplanted in the most experienced centers, because here they are not transplanted in the most experienced center. And then the third question was, is it true that the most experienced center have better results? And of course, the most experienced center have better results than those centers that perform less than 3 transplantations. So the conclusion of this paper is that the success rate was higher in experienced transplantation center, and the overnight transportation of ovarian tissue did not have a negative impact on the transplantation results. The transplantation to the pelvic peritoneum resulted in high success rate. So the implication for the clinical viewpoint is that we have to, but this is also reasonable for the economic resources. It has to be centralized, the ovarian tissue storage, and has to be centralized the center that do the transplantation. And the transplantation can be has to be made more successfully orthotopically and can be made into the peritoneum or in the ovary and in the peritoneum. So the second paper, I found this paper very interesting, is the molecular evidence against the preventive action of GnRH agonists in chemotherapy-induced damage in human ovocytes and granulosa cells. We all know very well that chemo radiotherapy can do a very important damage on the ovary, and the entity of this damage depends mainly by two things, by three things: the type of chemo or radiotherapy done, so the drug used and the schema of this drug used, and the age of the woman and the ovarian reserve of the woman. But there are some clinical evidences. Not all the prospective randomized trials published confirm this, but some of these large prospective randomized trials seems that if you cooperate with GnRH agonist, these regimens of therapy with chemo or radio, then you have a significantly higher chance to have the restorage of menstruation. But the restorage of menstruation does not mean the restorage of fertility, because fertility ends or almost ends 10 years before the menopause. So if you restore the menstruation and you restore the menstruation for, let's say, 3, 4, 5 years, it doesn't mean that that woman will be fertile. So all these studies addresses the issue of restoration of menstruation and not to the protection of fertility. But molecular mechanism of this protection, as they put forward to decrease the number of primordial follicles entering the differentiation and to reduce the blood flow at the level of the ovary, have been not demonstrated. There's only suggestions. So the aim of this study was to investigate whether GnRH acting via its cognate receptors protects against cyclophosphamide-induced DNA damage and cell death in human ovary. So what they did, they took ovarian cortical pieces, 15, from women of age between 14 and 37. Then they took granulosa cells, non-proliferating human luteinized granulosa cells, so after the ovulation, and proliferating non-luteinized human granulosa cells that were cultured, all these three things, for 24 hours with different drugs: cyclophosphamide, CYC, cisplatin, paclitaxel, radiation, TIC combination regimen. And were put into culture with these drugs, either with or without the GnRH agonist leuprolide acetate. So they evaluated at the end of this study these two groups, so the control group, drugs without GnRH agonist, drugs and radiation with GnRH agonist. They evaluated the DNA damage, ovarian follicle reserve, hormone markers, and the expression of anti-apoptotic genes between this group of study. So you can see here, the blue bar is the primordial follicles, the green bar is the preantral and antral follicle, and the first one is the control group. So the control group is statistically significantly compared to all the study groups. In the study group here, you can see cyclophosphamide alone or with GnRH agonist. And then you can see that the number of primordial and the number of preantral and antral follicle were significantly reduced either in the without GnRH agonist or with GnRH agonist. So the protective effect of GnRH agonist was absolutely not present. And it was present also with cisplatin, and it was not present also with paclitaxel. But paclitaxel had a dramatic effect on the pre-anterior anterior follicle, but not a significant damage on the primordial follicle, and similarly the radiation. What about the biomarkers, the anti-Müllerian hormones secreted in this study? So the addition of GnRH analog had no significant impact on anti-Müllerian hormone levels compared to chemotherapy or radiotherapy alone. And you can see this is the anti-Müllerian hormone coming from the control group, and this is after the use of CYC, either alone or with GnRH agonist, cisplatin, paclitaxel, and radiation. And you can see that either you use GnRH agonist or not, you have not any protection on this secretion of anti-Müllerian hormone. Similarly, the estradiol. And of course, if you look at the preantral and antral follicles, the number of these preantral and antral follicles in the control ovarian sample are significantly correlated with anti-Müllerian hormone and estradiol, but this is quite logical. And after the treatment, either you use the cyclophosphamide or alone or with GnRH agonist, you cannot find anymore this correlation or is almost absent. And also the expression of two anti-apoptotic genes was not preserved but even reduced with the co-administration of GnRH agonist. So in conclusion, the cyclophosphamide and cisplatin impacted both primordial and growing follicle fraction, while paclitaxel was detrimental to growing follicle only. The co-administration of GnRH agonist did not preserve follicle stockpile or improve steroidogenic activity or upregulate the expression of anti-apoptotic genes. And so the clinical implication here, they are gentlemen. The clinical implication is that apparently to this in vitro result, either you use GnRH agonist as a co-treatment or you don't, you do not modify the ovarian reserve of the patient. And if there are any protection effect, has to be still demonstrated, but apparently there's not. So the third one. The third one is what threshold values of antral follicle count and anti-Müllerian hormone levels should be considered in cancer patients candidates for osovitrification following in vitro maturation. So in vitro maturation of Kummel's oocyte complexes followed by osovitrification is an option for cancer patients seeking urgent fertility preservation. What does it mean, urgent? I can do an ovarian stimulation in 10, 12 days. And according to all the oncologists that we collaborate in Italy, you can postpone the start of chemotherapy of 10, 15 days without any, in the vast majority of cases, without any harm for the patient. Recent data indicate that in healthy patients, 8 to 20 vitrified oocytes would be required after ovarian stimulation to obtain a live birth. And antral follicle count and serum anti-Müllerian hormone have been reported to predict IVM success in PCOS patients, but little is known about the predictive value in cancer patients. So the aim of this study was to determine the threshold of antral follicle count and anti-Müllerian hormone under which it is not worth it to perform in vitro maturation of oocytes followed by in vitro followed by vitrification. So this is a retrospective study in 327 cancer patients aged 18-40 years who were candidates for oocyte vitrification following vitro maturation. The first thing that I think, how many possibility to have children in those 327 patients that performed in vitro maturation? The antral follicle count anti-mineral hormone were measured 48, 8, 72 hours before oocyte retrieval, whatever the phase of the cycle. Cumulocyte complexes were recovered under ultrasound guidance 36 hours after ACG priming. And logistic regression was used to determine threshold values of antral follicle count and anti-mineral hormone for obtaining at least 8, 10, or 15 vitrified in vitro maturation oocyte. So the vast majority were breast cancer. And the mean age was 31.7. Again, 31.7. And the ovarian reserve markers were incredibly high. The antifollicular count was 21. I mean, maybe I see an antifollicular count of 21, one out of 30 patients. And the serum antimillennial hormone was 4.7. The oocyte retrieval was performed equally in the luteal and in the follicular phase. The number of cumulocyte complex retrieved was 9.7. So 10 out of an antral follicle count of 21. And the number of metaphase 2 oocyte vitrified is 5.6, the mean number, out of 21. So if you, in this patient, we did the ovarian stimulation, we could easily retrieve a mean of 20 oocyte with easily a mean of 15 to 18 metaphase 2 oocyte vitrified. And what they found the threshold is that you must have an antral follicle count of 21 to have 10 vitrified oocyte. But what about the other 10 oocyte that you could vitrify doing that controlled ovarian stimulation? An anti-mullerian hormone of 3.8 to have 10 vitrified oocyte. So the conclusion is that antifollicle count serum anti-mullerian hormone values above 21 follicles and 3.8 nanogram per milliliter respectively are required for obtaining at least 10 in vitro maturation oocyte vitrified and to give some chances, some realistic chances to women of 30 to have a baby. Given these relatively high values, the combination of in vitro maturation and ovarian tissue cryopreservation should systematically be discussed for optimizing the fertility preservation strategy. And the clinical implications are vitrification of oocyte after in vitro maturation should be considered in the fertility preservation strategy when ovarian stimulation is unfeasible. But again, when is unfeasible? In particular, when markers of the follicular ovarian status are relatively high. What does it mean, are relatively high? It should be the opposite. Further investigation will be needed to objectively assess the real potential of these in vitro maturation oocyte after vitrification. I think, if I'm not wrong, that in this group of patients for fertility preservation, so far, no one single live birth rate has been reported after in vitro maturation, but I may be wrong. Therefore, even when a good controlled cumulus oocyte complex healed is expected, EVM in combination with ovarian tissue cryopreservation should be systematically encouraged. Okay. And then the last one. Control of ovarian stimulation in cancer patient candidates for fertility preservation is not associated with changes in the follicular output rate. So the follicular output rate is an important, let's say, marker of ovarian responsiveness to gonadotropins. The fourth is the number of follicles, is a ratio, is the number of follicles that at the end of the stimulation retrieval are larger than 16 to 20 millimeter, and compared to the number of pre-antral follicle at the beginning of the stimulation. So the question of this study was to assess whether the fourth can be different in cancer patients compared to the fertility, to the infertile patients. So if the cancer condition could alterate the responsiveness of the ovary to stimulation with exogenous gonadotrophins. So 71 cancer patients, aged 20 to 40 years, who were candidates for OSI vitrification following controlled ovarian hyperstimulation using GnRH antagonist protocol, were studied from July 2013 and December 2014. Ovarian stimulation characteristics and outcomes were compared with that of 91 infertile women, that was control group, included in the IVF embryo transfer program, matched for age, antrofollicular count, serum AMH level, and follicle starting, FSH starting dose. Antrofollicles were counted before FSH administration on and on the day of ovulation trigger. Fourth, like I said before, was determined by the ratio between the provolutive follicle count between 16 and 20 millimeter on the day of ovulation trigger, time 100 divided by the antrofollicle count at baseline. And so you can see that there was no difference between the fertility preservation group and the control group with regard to the fourth. The only difference is that the estradiol on the day of ovulation trigger was significantly reduced in the fertility preservation group compared to control group. That, I mean, it is indeed an advantage and not a disadvantage. So the conclusion is that the cancer status, it seems not to impair the responsiveness of the ovary to exogenous gonadotrophins. The only thing that it can be, because of course the numbers have to be confirmed, the only thing that it can be that the function of the granulosa cells can be a little bit impaired because the estradiol level were significantly lower in this group. So, in summary, Lieben-Tron says that the transplantation of ovarian tissue has to be done by experienced center, has to be done orthotopically in the peritoneum, and overnight transportation does not impair the OSA, OSA results. Bildig says that the GnRH agonist leuprolide acetate does not protect human ovarian samples and granulosa cells from the cytotoxic effect of chemo radiotherapy in vitro. Simone says that has to be considered for oocyte in vitro maturation a cutoff threshold, a threshold under which it is not worth it to do in vitro maturation and oocyte vitrification. And Duros said that the alteration in the granulosa cells function could account for the significant reduction of the estradiol levels that can be observed in the fertility preservation group after controlled ovarian stimulation, but the ovarian function of these patients is not impaired because the fourth is comparable between fertility preservation patients and infertile patients. Thank you for your attention.